Thank you to Ridge for sponsoring this video.
I'm gonna start this off with a disclaimer. Obviously, things are a little bit different. This isn't intended to be a dig at Lucas Cruikshank, who the actual creator of Fred. We're just here to poke fun at a movie that's a little below the normal film standards. It's another one for the terrible movies series, basically. We're not here to spark any drama. I don't hate Lucas, and I don't want you to hate on me either. It's just a guy who made a film. He probably enjoyed it, but I'm here to enjoy it for a whole nother reason, whether it's ironically or literally. Just come and join me along this wonderful, interesting ride. Alright. Fred! We all know Fred, right? Essentially being one of the first viral YouTubers in existence, and certainly the first to hit a million subscribers way back in 2009. God, 11 years ago. This guy was iconic back in the day, and I think perfectly encapsulates that kind of internet humor of the early 2010s. I mean, I know we have all sorts of generational divides in sense of humor now, with boomers hating their wives and judging their kids, Gen X using pop culture references, millennials self-deprecating themselves, and Gen Z seem to just love Dave or something. But honestly, this chipmunk lol random hyperactivity feels a whole lot more like Gen Z humor from these kind of days. Or maybe millennials just hadn't quite felt the dooms of reality at this point. Either way, I remember as a kid genuinely liking a good chunk of his old stuff on YouTube, and even when watching now with a bit more of a mature head on my shoulders, I can still kind of look at this a little appreciatively. Sure, it may not be everybody's cup of tea nowadays, and maybe even back then too, but does that mean that I have bad taste in the things that I watch as a kid and even now? No. So with Fred being one of the first super successes, the business of harvesting YouTubers for all the money that can be squeezed out of them started here. And though the wave of these kind of films was fairly small, I can only imagine the goldmine that's hiding within each of them. I mean, the angry video game nerd, nostalgia critic Smosh, and Logan Paul. Am I gonna pass up the opportunity to insert myself into the lives of these other YouTubers? Hell no, I'm not. But with Fred being the first, he had the largest impact, signing a contract with Nickelodeon to set him up with 3 movies and a TV show? My god, that's massive! I thought it was just the one. Well, either way, we're gonna dive headfirst into the very first film, releasing in September 2010 to some wonderful reviews. Let's go.
Hi, it's Fred!
Oof, from the very first frame, you could pretty much feel the datedness. So Fred immediately comes rushing to the camera in his typical Fredly fashion, shouting about an extended weekend and calling Fridays Fred Days or something, and generally just running balls to the wall. I'm struggling to follow what he's saying, but I can't exactly say that it's out of character for him. And honestly, as things get going, it's kinda charming. I'm getting some Diary of a Wimpy Kid vibes here. And after only seeing him in his low-budget Real House beforehand, it's weird to see him out in the world. I mean, now, suddenly, Fred comes off as having an entirely new layer to him. Or at least, he does for me. Oh yeah, I remember the advertising having Judy being played by Pixie Lott and how that was apparently a big deal. But forget that, apparently John Cena exists in this movie? This, like, predates the unexpected memes by, like, years! So Fred, in his obsessive way, stalks Judy as she drives home, playing it up for the kids in the audience and coming off as incredibly creepy when you think about it as an adult. In fact, honestly, when seeing Fred out in the wild like this, it feels like it could almost be leaning to some kind of autism study, but boy would that be a can of worms if they try to wrangle. Let's not think about that, or the logic of how Fred is constantly in front of the car. I guess he's a teleporting weirdo too. I mean, how else would you explain all the jump cuts? And here's Kevin, frozen on a blurred frame, acting like Kevin from Ed, Edd n Eddy, and he even has the same hat. Hey, what's going on here? So after a little more gushing over Judy, Fred has a plan going forwards.
I'm taking things to the next level with Judy.
Oh, Fred, no. You'll get cooties. And rambling on more, he starts to talk about his dad, who isn't around anymore.
He's not dead.
Huh, that execution actually wasn't too bad. He says how his window has the perfect view of Judy's house.
Creepy.
And then just randomly burst into screaming into the camera.
I need some food for my body because today was the worst Friday ever!
And it's one of those things where I feel like it almost kind of works on the YouTube format, but as a movie, this is just jarring and unnecessary. Is this what growing up feels like? So then after Fred randomly starts bursting out into screaming, Fred flashes back to being beaten by dodgeball, then goes and gives us a lol random line that then suddenly comes true, and then his head falls off. I mean, there's so much going on at such a wicked pace that I can't barely follow anything. Jeez! I know I talked about Gen Z humor before, but I've never actually felt like Dave before, you know? I'm almost gonna be sick. How far into this even are we?
You've got to be kidding me. Okay, we got to pick up the pace. What even is this plot?
Only the best from Amazon Prime. This isn't an ad. I'm just trying to incept you with the knowledge that this is on Amazon Prime. I swear this will come back later.
Fred talks more about his adoration with Judy. The food is too hot. He freaks out. He hoses himself. Dries up, remembers Kevin and Judy singing together, eeny meeny moza shirt for some reason, and in anger, imagines exactly what he wants. A pool party with Judy and Kevin getting arrested. And okay, finally now we get some progress. Fred wants to get over a wall to get to Judy's house. Actually, no, that's later too. First, he's gotta set up the pool for his fantasy. I mean, God, there's just a lot of nothingness in this film. And when you look at it without all the commentary, it honestly looks like the origin for some kind of villain kid in the making. So now we meet Bertha, played by Jenette McCurdy. I didn't know she was in this film. I mean, I guess it makes sense considering the whole Nickelodeon thing and the other productions they've made, but still. Now, Fred was gonna invite Judy to go swimming a la his old YouTube ways, but cancels out after realizing how lame it would be after chatting with Bertha. Now wanting girl advice from his dad.
The secret. His ruthless aggression.
What? Why is John Cena randomly his dad? Honestly, this is fantastic. It's his imagination, sure, but like, it's a good one. So Fred fantasizes singing with Judy in a way that's suddenly not very funny and discovers Kevin is a dancer, only for Kevin to turn around with...
Dude, she hates you, man. Why can't you just get that through your head, dude? She hates you. She tells me all the time.
And yeah, I'd believe it. Fred comes off as awfully creepy, socially cringy, and like the villain of this story sometimes. And Fred quips back to Kevin saying he can't sing, and it clearly affects him. Like, I'm starting to genuinely feel for Kevin over here. He's just a soft theater kid at heart. Introducing Fred's mum, who's probably one of my favorite characters for one single trait of hers, and that's that she actually acknowledges how incessantly loud Fred is, looking like she's always hungover and susceptible to noise. Now, these scenes with her aren't particularly good, but I get the tone that it was probably really fun to shoot. I'm not laughing at Fred randomly belting out his lines, I'm laughing at the improv kind of acting the two are doing just to try to sell the comedy of all the shouting. Does that make sense? This film is stupid, but boy does it feel like it's fun to be in. Like this next scene with John Cena again, probably one of the best executed scenes in the whole film, with them both attacking each other mid-conversation. This kind of slapstick comedy translates way better from YouTube to movies, and because of that, it just lands so much better.
I never have seen Judy's back door, but I bet it's really nice. And this is the trampoline, I got it from my mom. She uses it to train for work.
Oh, wow. So that's why she sleeps during the day. This film is crafty sometimes.
Hey guys, it's Daz!
I'm sorry, I had to do it once. Now, if you have made it this far, of course, do consider subscribing. Only you can help balance out my skewed unsub ratio account. And we are streaming today, twitch.tv/DazzReviews. And if you've been missing the streams, we are now releasing stream highlighted little condensed videos over on a new casual channel. So if you ever want to miss a stream, you can go see it there, I guess. Or that'll do. Yeah, I'll see you there. Or there. Or you might just stay here and watch some other videos. That's fine. You can do what you want. I can't stop you. I'm Fred.
So Fred attempts to trampoline the wall and fails, digging underneath where he finds a wire. At first, I was thinking maybe this is where the plot gets started, you know? Oblivious dumb boy accidentally discovers some underground facility conspiracy and upgrades from the toils of high school infatuation. But no, Fred just dies instead.
This.
Actually, we're just 18 minutes in. There's a whole other hour to this film. We gotta get moving. Hopefully the plot will soon. The digging fails, Fred cleans, imagines being invisible, dresses up as a woman, and discovers that Judy has in fact moved out, which promptly leads to... And honestly, it feels very YouTube-y. If only it was filmed on more than just a static tripod or something. That night, he imagines rescuing Judy from a kidnapping with his mum and dad, and, you know, looking at these kind of phases in 2020, I get a different kind of vibe. Fred was truly ahead of his time. So Fred stalks Judy's house and is determined to go there. I do like the joke, though, of wolves calling in the distance every time the woods are mentioned. So much more effective comedy, you know? You know what I think really doesn't help this film one bit? The soundtrack. It just sounds so bland. It literally sounds like one you'd find in YouTube's generic audio library of non-copyrighted tracks to use. At every stage, the music just feels like it was built for and by babies with a plastic music set. So with Fred on the move after one random catch-up scene later that I thought was maybe a reference to the channel, but no. He grabs some supplies, heads for the bus, is berated by Kevin, and gets on the wrong one out of pressure, where he meets Durf, the opposite, totally cool counterpart to Fred, which I guess is the perfect kind of character for this kind of universe that I'm surprised the movie invented and wasn't an established character on the channel, and then they barely went back to him in the future anyway. Okay, I mean, I guess he is kind of flat, but still. Anyway, Fred talks his ear off and eventually gets off the bus at the very end of the line to the water park, and Bertha's there.
Dude, I mean, sometimes I just don't like showing my body too much because, you know, too much sex appeal.
So, does Fred understand?
Fred gets buried in the sand for fun, eats a fly, and imagines the worst case scenario with a drowning Judy and a lifeguard Kevin ending with a duet. He rips out in slow-mo with more license-free music and strips at the laundromat. Then he gets kicked out to the car wash and does all of that, gets a really cool and genuine fun piece of 80s hair that unfortunately gets taken away immediately afterwards, and then almost robs a pet shop of a dog. Squirrel. Hey, at least that's an OG channel reference. Still, I just have to list the things that are going on to get through the plot at this point. Also, though, these gay couple shop owners present themselves in a really weird and over-the-top fashion. I don't get what they were going for here. Fred then gets distracted by someone speaking Spanish and just freaks out at just the concept.
Yeah. This is fine.
So he makes it to a dam, gets pep-talked and insulted by a security officer to go through the woods, and eventually does.
I mean, it sure does feel like a cacophony of distractions, doesn't it?
I'm almost getting sensory overload from it all. And you know, it's been a long while since he's actually addressed us directly. Is it only an at-home thing? Where does he think we are at this moment? Is he actually just talking to wolves? What even is the pacing structure of this movie? So Fred finds a talking deer that wants to sing with him randomly, and then they do sing a little bit randomly, and then Evan Wise appears, now older and wild. Fred then continues to scream again.
I got the ball! I got it!
So fine.
So after all of this lol random adventure, he gets to the bus stop again, is heckled by Kevin on a loop, he eats sardines, and Durf appears.
Lunch fail, man.
Yeah, this is still 2010. Fred goes to sleep with Durf tasked to wake him up when it's time, gets on the bus, brushes his teeth, buys a dog, and gets to Judy's where absolutely everything goes right. You know where this is going. Fred awakens again, cause Durf was never really there, gets to Judy's, and there's a party with him not invited. It's a proper cringe comedy scene.
I certainly feel uncomfortable.
Everyone laughs at Fred, his retorts are relatably weak and only dig him into a bigger hole that honestly actually strikes me in the soul. Kevin splatters him with food and Fred vomits over Judy, and it's all captured on everyone's outdated phones. There are no more buses, but he's picked up by one off shift in a somewhat wholesome moment. He's dropped off, addresses the audience, and doesn't actually scream. Is this his moment of maturing and coming to grips with reality over fiction, sparking a real sense of character development and recognizing?
Nope, he's just screaming again.
Fred really is a one-trick pony, isn't he? So he now discovers the video has been put on an ancient YouTube by Kevin. Is this gonna be the cruxing moment for Fred to create his own channel and birth the real-life Fred channel in a way of mixing the canons of the universes? No, why would that ever happen? Angry, Fred decides instead to set up his own party and not invite anyone, showing up at Kevin's to dis-invite him to the party, and Kevin looks genuinely distraught. Like, what is going on with this man? Does he actually want to hang out with Fred here? He's a complex soul. Fred continues to shoot down everyone until eventually he reaches Bertha, who says she's on his side, not being invited to the party either. And with a change of heart, he chooses to re-invite her to the party instead. And they both seem wholesomely happy and invested in it, honestly, with the loser kids coming together to have their own fun instead. They plug up the windows, film his mum, and do all sorts of DIY filmmaking with fans, costumes, cardboard silhouettes, blending a magazine for confetti, and honestly, it all kind of plays out like a Home Alone montage. part where you're trying to understand how every piece possibly comes together to make logical sense later. All played over your classic pop song sounding montage, though actually, if it wasn't something different every shot, I'd say it kind of overstays its welcome. I mean, there's a lot of techniques they show off here and it just kind of keeps going. And the next morning, Fred has been editing all night, now having two sides of him, with one being much more doubtful and anxious. The results of childhood trauma and embarrassment. I guess that's kind of a character development. In the wrong direction. He uploads the video accidentally for us all to see, creating the perfect fake party with all sorts of camera tricks, and surprise, surprise, it's using a Pixie Lott track underneath.
So, does that mean that she exists in Fred's universe? How does this work?
The party video as well overstays its welcome for a very long time with all sorts of different themes and tone changes, with everyone puking randomly, because in Fred's world that's what's peak comedy, and in our world apparently that's what kids wanted to see. And then moving on to a musical remix out of the sounds of the party before eventually finishing up. And before we reach our proper ending, thank you to our sponsorship today, the Ridge Wallet. Fred's got an old school computer, but you should have a modern day wallet. It doesn't awkwardly fold or bulge in your pocket or anything, and the materials it's made from are solid and great protection. It's one of those things no one really thinks to get a new one of, but it's definitely worth it. So go to ridge.com/daz and use the code DAZ to get 10% off, as well as a 45-day money-back guarantee if you're not a fan. It's too convenient not to. And with such a fantastic video, now suddenly everyone at school loves Fred and totally wanted to be at that party. Epic fail for them all. Though they all suspiciously reference Fred during his entire adventure, even for the parts that no one was around to see. And of course, it loops back round to Kevin, who is clearly upset by how often he's being asked about not being invited to Fred's party. The boy's just got some complex feelings, alright? He just wants to have fun, I guess. With the mum and Fred talking the day after, Fred zooms and enhances onto Judy's new house to somehow reveal Toilet Man through the window, and it wraps up our final mystery as...
That was about... 15 years ago? I'm 15.
Though it clearly doesn't get into Fred's head, as he imagines John Cena anyway. And as a final plot twist to the movie, who shows up at Fred's house but none other than Judy herself, wanting to apologize for the embarrassment of last time and wanting to hang out and sing together. Kevin's about to cry on the street, Durf approves on the couch, Fred screams at the audience one final time,
lovely,
and Judy comes in. That's the ending. So remember kids, if you want to be popular, you gotta fake it with your social media presence. Creeping and stalking over your girl is all good, and fawning over the popular girl whom you have nothing in common with is the correct path to take in order for true happiness. Social skills are a thing for losers, and sticking it to everybody else is how you should go about your life. Though really, when you look at it more deeply, there could totally be a dark underlying theme with Fred. He's got a single parent who's borderline neglectful and potentially alcoholic, there's clearly a lack of social interactions that spirals into him never developing the skills for it, he has a crazy vivid imagination he lets play out sometimes, as well as hallucinations separately that he seems surprised by when they start or literally cannot decipher away from reality. And towards the end, everything seems to be conveniently perfect for that ending to the point of just hopping logic. So maybe that last day was one final mental meltdown of fantasizing the best version of outcomes for Fred after uploading that video. But even if that is the most interesting turn I can imagine for this film to go in, there were a handful of other opportunities that arrived and were kind of avoided. Like sure, maybe the whole conspiracy wire thing was never really gonna be a thing, but what about that one helpful bus driver who helped him out of kindness and a big tip? Imagine if Fred had accidentally assisted the lives of all the people he met on his adventure, instead of just screaming at all of them. Being valuable in a community sense while still ridiculed at school. Instead, the film doubled down on its origins with that YouTube style in a movie skin, and the direction simply didn't lean into it well enough. If there was a hint of a handheld perspective, I think it could have translated so much better. Imagine like the opening of Spider-Man Homecoming with Fred constantly vlogging his experience rather than all these static professional shots.
Iron Man, Black Widow, whoa, who's that new guy?
John Cena!
I'm sorry, I had to do it once, you know? And oh my god, the screaming. I get it, it's part of the character, but man, for a 3-minute video, it's passable. Funny in the moment with that montage style editing, but dragging it out across an 83-minute runtime, it couldn't have come off any worse. That being said, while the story is poorly structured and slapped together, the soundtrack is negatively impacting the film and the themes and direction are just completely lackluster, it's not necessarily a fault on Lucas himself. This is a product of its time for a particularly young audience. But I actually looked up what he's up to nowadays, and it's clear he's certainly adapted his humor for the moderner age. Just one glance at some of his latest videos clearly feels like it fits right into today.
You've all been waiting for me to do a mukbang, and here it is. Give it to me, Zaddy. Hot damn.
So, you know, it's good to hear he's still doing good now. And he doesn't regret these films either, saying that they were still fun to make, which is kind of what I suspected after watching this. And that's what we're here for, really. Whether it's with the film or at the film, we're still somewhat laughing thanks to these terrible productions. I've no idea how well the sequels or the TV show fixed all of these issues, but I'm sure one day I'll be covering them too. Though I'll probably cover some of the other YouTuber movies first. For now, my name's been Daz, you didn't really care, and I'll see you in a bit.
So what did you think of my outfit? This was the first, like, actually full frontal attempt to recreate an actual outfit accurately. Why did I phrase it like that? I don't know. It was actually foreshadowed in Trolls, hence why I've still got a little stain on my chest. On the off chance that Lucas sees this? Hi. Sorry for stealing your identity for like 20 to 30 minutes. But hey, I liked your stuff. Ironically, but it looked like a lot of fun. So, nice to see you. I mean, you just see me. I can't see anything. I need these glasses for something.